Can you hear me? Yes, okay, I'm amplified. Hi, everybody. My name is Kim Utani. I'm a senior programmer here at the festival. Welcome to the 2018 Sundance Film Festival, and welcome to today's panel, which is called Fresh Faces. This panel was inspired by some of the most exciting performances we saw this year, and these are the fresh faces you will be meeting in a few minutes. I just want to thank our panelists for taking time out of their busy Sundance schedules to be with us. It's truly an honor. And thank you, all of you, for coming, and for those of you who are tuning on online. I just want to introduce to you today's panelists. We have first Dominique Fishback, who is in the next film, Night Comes On.
Hi, thank you for having me.
We have Mr. Fancy this year, Kelvin Harrison Jr., who is in three films, Assassination Nation, Monster, and Monsters and Men. And also in Assassination Nation, and one of my favorite supermodels, Hari Neff. And finally, the star of Skate Kitchen, please welcome Rachelle Vinberg. We are so lucky to be able to collaborate with New York Times, Times Talks, and who help us put together some of these panels and launch us out into the stratosphere as we should be. I'm so thrilled to be able to introduce the creative director of Times Talks. Please welcome Michelle Gray.
Thank you so much, Kim. And thank you to Cinema Cafe and to Sundance Film Festival. Times Talks is thrilled to be back here again this year. It's always an honor and a privilege to work with you. So for those of you who aren't familiar with Times Talks, it's the New York Times live conversation platform that pairs New York Times journalists with the biggest and brightest minds from the fields of art, literature, science, fashion, and of course, film. It's an honor and a privilege for the Times to be celebrating the new and seminal voices of the next generation. And mentoring today's panel is one of the New York Times' favorite contributing writers, who is attending his 15th Sundance Film Festival, will be Logan Hill. So without much further ado, thank you.
Yeah, I've been coming a while, and the best thing about coming to Sundance for a while is that you get to brag about how you were there when the actor had their first film at Sundance. I was there. I interviewed Jennifer Lawrence when she was here. Today, all you guys are going to be able to say, you were there when you met these four terrific actors. I've seen three other films. I haven't seen Assassination Nation because they haven't screened it yet, but I've seen the others, and I can vouch for them. These are terrific, terrific performances that Sundance has selected, and we're really thrilled that you're here. So we'll chat a little bit, and then we'll open it up to questions. And the first question is going to be two-part. We're going to have you each introduce your films, tell us a little bit about them, but then first you got to tell me first performance you did in front of a crowd that you remember. This would be if you're in front of your family, in front of a school play, first performance you did, and then tell us a little bit about your movie here at Sundance. Kelvin, you're starting because you're right next to me.
So should I start with the first performance?
Yeah, first performance.
Okay.
Actually, we'll do first performance all down the line, then we'll introduce the films.
Okay, cool. My first performance. My favorite movie growing up was probably Sleeping Beauty.
Nice.
And so I performed Maleficent's entire scenes for my parents, and they filmed it. There you go. All
right.
I think first, my mom used to say I was very dramatic, and they used to call me Drama D. So I think when I was like five, she used to say that I would do the Wicked Witch of the West, and be like, I'm out, and like melt to the floor and like excruciating pain when I was like five. So that's pretty cool. But I was with MCC's youth company, which is a theater in New York, and they allow you to, as teenagers, to write and perform your own things. So I remember it was my first year. I wrote a monologue, and I knew it. I memorized it before everybody. And this was the show that we were doing in front of like different schools. So I go there, and I'm like doing my monologue, and they laugh at a part that I didn't think they were going to laugh at. And then I was like, But I mean, I skipped to the part I know, which is the rule. Just skip to the part that you know. And I did that, and nobody noticed. But for me, I felt like I was there for like 5 minutes, being like, how could you do this? But it was great, yeah.
Well, I was always really into sports when I was younger. And I don't know if this is considered a performance, but the first time that I was allowed to pitch in softball was like, I consider my first performance, because like, it was just like the anticipation. I'd never pitched before. I remember like talking to my brother on the sideline as I was pitching, like, am I doing this right? Am I doing this? I don't know, so.
How'd it go?
It went good. I mean, I continued pitching, so mm-hmm. I mean, it was fun. Like softball, Little League, yeah. Shout out.
I used to go to a creative arts day camp called Charles River Creative Arts Program, and I played Titania in A Midsummer Night's Dream, the musical. Yeah.
Now we'll talk about the films. Kelvin, you can't talk about all three. We can only talk about one today. And I think we've got a clip for Monster, where you've got the lead. So we'll play that clip in a little bit. But you want to intro it and tell us a little bit about the movie?
Yeah. So Monster is about a 17-year-old honor student who's also a filmmaker from Harlem who is on trial for a murder. It's based on the Walter Dean Myers novel, Monster. I play Steve Harmon.
Great. We'll take a look at that clip.
I'm not guilty.
That's great. You should have said I didn't do it.
I didn't do it. Do you believe me?
It doesn't matter what I believe. I'm gonna do my job.
Got a minute?
It's okay.
I know you have an impossible caseload, and I'm going home at 6, so why not make it easy on everybody?
He's only 17.
So what? His actions led to a murder, and if you keep going, I'm going to nail this kid.
He didn't do it.
What are you talking about? I got the surveillance tape. I got witnesses who put him there.
Your witnesses?
I got the old lady. Hey, she's very credible. Take the offer. You're wasting everybody's time and money.
20 years? He's a good kid. He's never been in trouble before. He's got great parents. He's not who you think he is.
He looks the part to me.
Man, I feel like we have to... We'll talk a little bit about each film. I don't want to just move on from that after that. Do you want to tell us a little how you got involved in the project, how you got cast?
Yeah, I actually auditioned, it was that earlier that year, in February, and I read the script, and I remember just seeing like this kid, and I was like, wow, he's so different. He's this sensitive artist who's just trying to like find out who he is in life, and I was like, I identify with that, I relate. And I auditioned, my tape was awful.
What makes a bad tape? What was bad about that tape?
It was me getting in my own way. I literally just was like this. I didn't feel like I can authentically tap into it just yet. Yeah. And it took me 12 hours to make a really bad tape. Yeah. And fast forward, I did a film called It Comes at Night, and the casting director, A.V. Kaufman, was the casting director on that, and she was also the casting director on Monster and Monsters and Men. Mm-hmm. She saved my life. She was like, you know, what does Kelvin want to do after It Comes at Night? He should read the script called Monster. I told my manager, I was like, yeah, we read that. It was bad, bro. You remember? And he was like, well, really try it. So I Skyped Anthony Mandler, the director, and he really made me feel okay with where I was with the script and my insecurities about taking on the role. He was like, you know, a lot of this movie is about being in the gray and about growing up and about not having all the answers. And so I just said, okay, I trust you. Here we go. I don't have any answers for you just yet, and I'm going to figure this out as we go, and you're going to have to help me. And he was like, I got you.
You're up next.
Well, my film is called Night Comes On, and I play Angel, and she's a young girl who's just released out of juvie on a eve of her 18th birthday, and she's on a mission to avenge her mother's death. But in order to get to the man who did it, she has to bring along her 10-year-old sister for the journey. And I think her conflict is that she's, you know, tunnel vision towards this murder that she wants to perform, but then she has her 10-year-old sister who's so full of life pulling her in the direction of life, and he's the direction of death. So.
All right, let's take a look at the clip. I was going to ask you about casting, but after watching you two together again, I want to just ask you about working with your co-star. Can you tell us a little bit about how you two found that naturalism together? Because you're just wonderful together in this film.
Thank you. Well, Jordana Sparrow, who's a co-writer and director, she wanted us to have rehearsals, so we would meet at her house and have rehearsals. But a lot of times, because Angel, she's dead set on murdering this person, I felt like I wanted to have access to her the whole time. So even if it was like in between takes and it was cut, I would still be like mentally in that spot, even in rehearsal. And Tatum would be like, "Dom, are you mad at me?" And I'm like, "No, I know I'm not mad at you, but I had to explain to her that through the course of this film, she's on a mission, and so I have to stay true to that." But I think that allowed the relationship to be, you know, in the film, they have their arguments, they have their fights, but that's what sisters do. So I didn't want to baby her so much. I wanted to just kind of throw her out there. This is her first film, and she's amazing. So, and her parents was really like dead set on her learning from me. So I said, well, if it was me, I would want the actress to treat me like anybody else, not baby me or whatever. So I kind of like if I wasn't in the mood, I wouldn't talk, or I would talk, or, you know. And I think that kind of helped the relationship of the film.
All right, Rachelle, do you want to tell us a little about Skate Kitchen?
Sure. So I play Camille in Skate Kitchen, and the film is semi-autobiographical, based on like my friends and I in real life. But basically, Camille is this girl from Long Island, a skater girl, who becomes befriended by a crew of New York City skater girls. And they kind of take her in, and she finds herself completely immersed into this crazy, new, like unfamiliar life of living in New York City, skating, and friendship. And I guess like the main conflict in the film is just her figuring out how to deal with having friends, because it's something that's completely foreign, and also dealing with you know, kind of like the enemies of her new friend group, which she finds herself in kind of an issue with. But basically it's just about friendship and skateboarding, having fun. Yeah.
And you'll see a little bit of that.
Oh shit. Yo, put some bangers on this. Let's go, let's get these clips.
I really didn't, and he was just using my board.
This is our job, all right?
I totally understand that, but can I just please have the board back? Like, I'm not trying to fight you or be disrespectful like them. I'm just trying to get the board back. Please?
Take this board, all right?
Come on. I just let him borrow it.
And get the fuck from around here.
Yeah, no.
Now let me catch you out here again, okay?
Yeah, have a good night.
I love that scene, and in a sense too, you basically came up with the name of the film as well, Skate Kitchen.
Yeah.
Tell us a little bit about Skate Kitchen.
All right, so Skate Kitchen. When I was younger, I used to watch a lot of YouTube videos of girl skaters, and like Alyssa Steamer, and I noticed that on the comments, a lot of comments would say, "This girl should be in the kitchen," you know, she should be making me a sandwich. And that really stuck with me. And I noticed that this is something that people, you know, it's a degrading idea that has been used constantly when women are trying to do something that's deemed like masculine or just trying to do something different. And so I figured when I met all the Skate Kitchen girls, you know, all the girls in the film, we just decided to kind of call ourselves Skate Kitchen. That way, like, we're allowed to skate if it's like a kitchen, right? So.
And I have to ask you the discovery question. You have one of the best discovery stories here.
Okay, so I was chilling with Nina, which is another girl in the film, on the train, on the G train. And this woman with like long blonde hair, you know, kind of creepy, just like came up to us and was like, "Hey, my name's Crystal Moselle. I'm a director. Are there more of you guys?" Like, and we're like, "Yeah, there is." And then she was low-key filming me, and like, she actually has the footage. It's really weird. But anyway, I'm only saying that because, like, you know, I love her. But yeah, so she just met us on the train and started hanging out with us, and we brought her to all the skate parks, to, like, introduced her to all of our friends. Like, everyone in the film is our friend. So that was like really fun to be able to do, and so it's just a really big family. Yeah.
All right, Harry, tell us about Assassination Nation.
Assassination Nation poses the question, what if somebody posted everything in your cloud on the internet? Your photos, your texts, your search history. And what if somebody did that to you and every single person in your town, everyone you grew up with, your husband, your daughter, the principal of your child's school. So somebody does this, and it tears the small American town of Salem apart, and things go crazy, and four teenage girls wind up at the center of it all. I play one of them. Her name is Bex, and she's just looking for love and trying not to die.
Let's take a look at the clip.
I read this quote from this writer whose name I forget, but it said something like, 10% of the population is cruel, and 10% is merciful, and the other 80% can be swayed in either direction. I'm also pretty sure that writer has never seen a World Star fight vid, or 4chan, or Twitter.
Slay him high. We got some Salem bitches on the motherfucking run.
Because at the end of the day, nothing unites us like a good tragedy.
We're good people! We're good people!
What do you want to say about this one? You want to talk about getting cast, or you want to tell us about how this film fits in this moment? It feels very timely.
Yeah, it's very right this second. You know, it's a little bit of a mysterious teaser clip. Premieres tonight at midnight. I think Assassination Nation is a film that forces us to look at the way we filter ourselves through the internet, the way we reconcile our personal, intimate selves with social and political environments, and the way these things are laid bare, you know, in the current day. You know, things come out about people in the town, things that you'd never expect, things that carry stigma, things that make people angry, things that make people, you know, distrust authority figures, and, you know, any kind of shame or ostracism that you can think of, you know, whether it's something specific today, you know, going back to the same things we were talking about in the Salem witch trials, it's all in this film. And I think that particularly the internet and the way we share things on the internet as a funnel for inhumane behavior, for acting and saying things that we wouldn't do normally in person, you know, there's this quote at the center of the film, as it said, you know, 10% of the population is good, 10% is bad, and the other 80 can be swayed either way. And I think that, you know, we've seen in the past year or so how these numbers can be swayed and what sways them. So it really feeds into what's happening right now, I think, in a way that's exciting and terrifying. I was terrified when I first read the script. Terrified. So.
I mean, it's hard to watch. I mean, all of these films feel very of the moment. We were talking earlier about Monster, which, you know, is a book that's been out for decades, but couldn't feel more timely right now. So maybe I'll go back down the line again, and we could talk a little bit about how you feel your film is coming out at the right time, or at a time where it matters.
Yeah, I mean, Monster is really a cautionary tale, and it's really to kind of allow people to see that, you know, this black boy life matters, you know, and that in this social climate with everything going on, it's more complicated than just black and white. It's more complicated than just, oh, he did something wrong and he should be prosecuted and handled in that matter. And it kind of brings back the humanity in this kid, you know?
Because it does play with that gray area where he, you know, he's not entirely, like, it's not like he was completely the wrong kid picked up. He has a connection to this murder that happens, but it's not, he wasn't pulling the trigger. That, you know.
Right, right. It's interesting. It's growing up. It's a coming of age story. Steve is just curious. Mm-hmm. He's trying to figure out, he's trying to become a man. He's like, I see all these people in my city and in my town, and I'm just like, who are you and what are you doing? And I want to be involved. I want to find my power. I always talk about how it's impotence versus potency. And he's trying to find this power where he feels like he's constantly feeling impotent, you know, powerless and yeah.
I bet some of that rings true with your character, the sense of powerlessness and wanting to take some control over her life again.
For sure, yeah. I actually think that she feels like she has no life to live. And when you have no life to live, nothing else matters. So she was taken through, the murder happened, of her mother happened when she was 10 years old, and so she spent her time going through foster care, and then ended up in juvie for many different reasons at many different times, and I think that the system failed her, and as you can see, so this film takes you through a couple of days, but, you know, it's not like a flashy film. It's just you're following this one person through her day and through her night, where she gets out of juvie and her housing situation falls through, and so she has to find shelter in the hallway of a stranger's building. You know what I mean? So, like, we follow the course, and this happens to so many foster kids when they age out, and I think that's really important. I think we get to see this young girl. I think it's very easy for us to cast people aside when we don't understand them, but I think Angel gives us a chance to see, and although she's looking to murder somebody, I think we feel for her, and we kind of understand her. And I think a lot of people hope that she does it. Some people hope that she doesn't. And I think it makes us question what our morality, right, you know, because of what he did. And we're like, yeah, do it. And then we're like, no, don't do it. So, yeah.
Yeah, and I gotta say, that question, and you really don't know what's gonna happen through the whole film.
Oh, I'm glad.
Yeah. and if, you know, one thing that, you know, obviously is of the moment is this idea of spaces that are male dominated and women claiming a place for themselves. Can we talk a little bit about how you feel this film fits into that moment?
Yeah, I think right now we're living in a time where female empowerment is really emphasized, and, like, you know, just everything going on, and even in this industry and just everywhere, it's like time's up. And in skateboarding, it's a really male dominated sport. And if you're a female trying to get into it, it can be very intimidating. You get a lot of attention going into parks. I mean, it could be positive, negative, but attention nonetheless. And I just feel like this film really portrays the rawness and the realness of just being a girl, you know, not being a pretty girl, being a girl, like talking about, you know, rowdy things or just being crazy. Like, we do that too. And I think it's important to show that and to be vulnerable and not, you know, be scared about what other people will think or how they might see our behavior as not being ladylike or whatever. So, I mean, just even going through this film has helped me become more comfortable with myself. And I think that goes for the other girls as well. We all really learned a lot, and I think it's important for other people to, you know, learn as well. Yeah.
And a question, maybe we'll start, a question for all of you. You already did the timeliness question on Assassination Nation. But I'm curious, like, for all of you, you want to say a little more?
I mean, I just feel like if you want to make a film about rage, if you want to make a film about anger, if you want to make a film about righting a wrong and shifting a paradigm in 2018, that's probably going to be a film about women, and it probably should be a film about women.
And I'm interested. I've interviewed quite a number of actresses, you know, who've further on in their career, actors in the further on in their career, talking about this moment of Time's Up and Me Too. It seems like as someone breaking through, as four actors breaking through at this moment, it must feel very different than if this wasn't all going on. If the women, if this activism hadn't been going on, the reporting, honestly, of folks at places like the New York Times. But as you're reading these stories and you're talking to colleagues and you're hearing these stories come out. How has it changed your sense of what it's like to have a career in this business?
Well, I guess I'm going to compare it to skateboarding because I compare everything in life to skateboarding. Skateboarding is just a metaphor of life, honestly. But I mean, I'm thinking about it like going to do a trick, trying to hit a handrail. Like, you know what the end goal is. You know what you want. And to get there, though, you're going to have to go through the whole fear stage, you know, the whole like hesitation and all that. But at the end of the day, you know that you just have to go for it. And that applies with this, like you just be honest and, you know, trust yourself and trust others and hope that you have people behind you backing you up. And now I think like that this is going on, there's more support than ever. I mean, it's awesome. Just like when people are supporting you and trying to land the trick, same thing.
Anyone else want to chime in on what it feels like to sort of be at this moment? Does it change the sense, you know, like these stories of casting couches, these stories of what it takes to get a role, or the kind of pressure that's put on young actors, you know, have been around, but they've never been so explicit. Does that change the way you understand, like, what it's taken for the people ahead of you to do what they've done?
Well, I want to say, because I'm currently a series regular on A Deuce for HBO, and that's about the rise of the porn industry in the 1970s, and I play a prostitute named Darlene, and it's created by David Simon, who created The Wire as well. And I did a show previously with him called Show Me a Hero, and when we were doing ADR for it towards the end, he came up to me and he said, I don't know if you heard about my new show, it's called A Deuce. I was like, no. He's like, well, I have a role with you in mind, but it's not a role you take just to take it. So I want you to read the scripts, and if you don't want to do it, no harm, no foul. And I love working with David Simon, and I feel so fortunate that this is my reality, that doing a show like this, I didn't have to experience the things that so many other women have experienced. So I feel very fortunate in that, and knowing that this man could create so much great content and still be a gentleman, and George Pelicanos as well. So it gives me hope. I feel very protected. I feel very honored to be here at this time, and to have the women who have experienced that speaking up, it just gives me, it just makes me feel protected, like this, like a row of women just pushing forward, and I'm right here like, okay, can I come with you? And they're like, yeah, come with me.
David Simon's being practical too. He said that he's just trying to develop this relationship with you so you give him work later.
He did say that on Twitter. That was a big deal. He said, yeah, we're just giving her work so when George and I can't remember any words of how to put words together, she promised us jobs. So, I promised him jobs.
But the idea of he has got a lot of faith in you, you know. One thing I'm interested in, all of you, you come into acting from different backgrounds, right? And I do think that's something interesting about this younger generation of actors, whether it's music, theater, skateboarding, modeling. There's a lot of crossover, and the Venn diagrams get interesting with all of you. Are there ways you think that your other talents or your other experience bleed into your acting?
I can go to that. I grew up in Brooklyn, East New York, and East New York. But I always wanted to be an actress since I was a little girl, but I only knew acting from TV. I would stay up late and watch I Love Lucy all the time and just be like, I want to do that. I want to have a show like her, you know. But I didn't know theater, and so when I tried to get into acting, theater was the first thing that invited me in, and I learned about finding my light and projecting my voice. And also with this theater company, you didn't just do other people's work. At a young age, you had to write your own stuff, and I really think that helped me. I'm a spoken word poet. I have a one-woman show that I wrote called Subverted, and it's about the destruction of black identity in America. And it has two sides. It has a slave side and a modern-day side, and they parallel to show comparisons. And I feel like because I got my start with the MCC Youth Company, I'm able to have a voice and to talk about things that really matter to me and to be a voice in for my family and for the people who come from hoods like mine that don't have the opportunity. You know, I went to a private university, and that's not easy for a lot of people from low-income communities. So I just feel honored that I get to use my voice and from a young age know that my voice mattered, you know.
Your other experiences? Yeah, go
all right,
for it.
Well, in skateboarding, the whole process of like filming and getting clips and putting out skate parts is just like a big part of skateboarding. And when you're trying to get a clip, it takes a lot of work. It doesn't just take first try. I mean, sometimes we're lucky, but that never happens. So like that, I guess, kind of reminded me of how the process was while we were filming the movie, you know, constantly doing different takes and all that. So it's like, I feel like skateboarding prepared me for this, and to kind of understand that it's not just gonna happen right away, or you need to, you know, strive for perfection, and like, yeah. Thank you, skateboarding. Shout out.
You have a background in music, right?
Yeah.
Is it trumpet?
I play piano and trumpet. You know, when you're from New Orleans, you better play an instrument. Yeah, my parents are musicians. My dad's a saxophonist. He was classically trained, and then he ended up transferring into like jazz. And then my mom was a ballerina, and she ended up becoming a jazz vocalist. And so music was a huge part of my house. To this day, my dad's like, "Are you practicing your trumpet?
Are you?
Because
practicing
that's your
trumpet?
Ticket." I'm not, but. but you know, what it taught me was a work ethic. You know, my dad comes from being classically trained. It's about practicing. And, you know, I would go to school from 8 to 3, and then I would go to a creative arts school from 3 to 4, and I did jazz piano, and then I would go home and I have to practice for 3 hours. Wow. So it's like discipline, 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 and then you better get your homework done. Yeah. So, you know, and then every summer I go to 3 jazz camps every summer. So it was intense. And I guess that taught me to be focused, and it taught me to be patient with myself, and I think that's transferred into like this business, because there's a lot of stuff going on a lot of the time, and this, and I have to stay focused and be not so hard on myself, and just make sure that I'm being good at time management.
Yeah. And how about modeling?
Well, I always acted when I was a kid, and when I got into college and I was studying theater, I studied theater at Columbia, and like they had a great theater department, but there was something that made me feel like maybe I wasn't gonna fit in this industry. Like, I didn't really feel comfortable with the way I was being seen, and I wasn't comfortable with the parts I was being given. And I thought that, you know, not like from an ego perspective, just like I felt wrong inhabiting these parts. So I actually stepped away from theater, and I was doing performance art. I performed at the New Museum. I performed at Art Basel twice. I was kind of doing this like artist thing, and one of my performances got recorded and found its way to Cynthia Nixon, and I like, and she brought me in for a theater audition based on this like kooky performance art piece that I did at like a downtown like artsy performance space in the Lower East Side. So I sort of found my way back into it, you know, with the help and support of so many people. I also modeled for a couple years now, and I'm focusing on acting too, but I think just, I like to tell stories. And I think whether you're modeling or you're acting or you're writing, you're telling a story, and telling a story in front of a camera is something that unites fashion and film and television. So I was scared to talk about it because it was this weird blender of things that just sort of led me to where I was. And then I graduated college and did Transparent, and it's like, okay, I'm an actor now. Woo! Like,
did Transparent? Whatever.
Well, yeah, but no, but it wasn't like I was like hustling going to auditions. It was like I did the modeling thing, and I was on Instagram, and I was doing performance art, and I was just kind of like sticking my thumb into all these little pies when I was like 19 years old, trying to figure out who I was, and then it all just sort of locked into place. Not for any one of those particular reasons, but because of all of them. And I think that when you're young, you just need to try it all. And it's just gonna help you specify what it is you wanna do and what's gonna feel good.
At any age, you should try it all, right? It's never too late. If we got life and we got breath, right? We should just try it, yeah.
I'll open this up to Q&A in just a second. So think about your questions. We'll pass around a microphone. My last question is that I noticed that all four of you have films with the directors either making their first or second movie. So I wonder if you feel like you're kind of in this together as people that are, do you feel like you're kind of breaking through together at the same time with your directors? Does that change the dynamic on the set?
Well, yeah, I mean, this whole thing I've kind of seen, it's like, I feel like it's been a journey. I mean, I worked with Crystal Mozell and she's this amazing female director, and it's her first narrative feature. She did the Wolfpack, a documentary, before. But, you know, the one thing I really love about her is that she was super honest with everything. Like, she would say, like, you know, this is new for me. And when she messed up, she would say it. And, like, that's, I feel like, so it's so important to have that kind of person as a role model because, you know, we're all not perfect, and, like, we're going to make mistakes, and it's all a learning process. And I just view this whole thing as a learning process, and yeah, I'm sure she does as well.
I mean, for me as well, I love first-time directors because they don't have egos. And not saying the older ones do, but I don't even work with many of them. But there's something about the energy and like the hard work and like the just gratefulness, and like they're just so excited, and I'm just so excited, so then we're both like, we're so excited. And then we make a cool movie, and it's really fun, and then usually they're much younger too, like Ronaldo's really young, and you know, it feels like a friendship rather than like this person that you just really like look up to, and it's a different type of experience, so it's really exciting to go on that journey with them.
I mean, with Sam, he just approached the process with so much openness and so much love and so much trust in his actors. I think he understood that, you know, we are building this work together. It's not, you know, his film as a known, you know, director might sort of conduct himself that way. He really did welcome a collaborative process, especially as a man who wrote this film with four women at the center. He opened himself wide open to discussion. Talk to me if you feel comfortable. If something feels wrong, talk to me. That is the only way to, you know, for, in this case, a man to make a film about women. If you want to engage, as you should, in your work with people who are different from you, you need to welcome those people into the process. And I feel like as a new filmmaker, he had that open-mindedness and that foresight. And there were discussions, some of them were easy, some of them were hard, but we had them. And I hope that the love and the trust comes through in the film because it was certainly felt.
I think for me, Jordana, she wanted to come from it in the kind of theater way because we had rehearsals in her apartment. And I think for me, because I have a theater background, I really enjoy that. You know, being on TV shows, everything's going so fast. I like to journal as my characters. I like to summarize scenes and put music to it and make analogies and stuff. And I remember having a great analogy for like something on Show Me a Hero and knew that like Paul Haggis just didn't have the time to hear my analogy. So I was like, damn. But it was good. I was like, this is good too. But so when Night Comes On, I got to, you know, call Jordana anytime and we watched documentaries together so we could have a sort of language on set if she was looking for something and I might have pointed something out in a documentary. So now she'll see me and she'll say, Dom, like Baltimore City. And I'm like, oh, I know exactly what that means. You know, so, you know, she took the time with us, and because we had a first-time actress, a 10-year-old, a lot of things a lot of things was slower, but she definitely had the patience and was open to suggestions and feedback and made it a team effort. So
we'll take some questions from the audience. Raise your hand and we'll get you a mic. How about Wary in the back there by the bookshelf?
Thanks to all of you. Congratulations.
Thank you.
I can't wait to see what you guys do. I guess my question, it's been a little bit kicked off by something Dominique said, but I'm curious, as actors who seem to be working a little bit outside of just being interpretive actors and possibly working in a space where you're creating actors, what are the roles that you are, I guess, really pumped to play, and what are the films that you would love to see made that you could be a part of?
Well, I would love to play Assata Shakur. Yeah. But I would hope and pray that somebody gets in contact with her and she approves of it, because I don't want to do it if she doesn't approve of it. But that's definitely a dream of mine. And it's so funny, because I'll do like hard, edgy stuff like HBO, and then people are like, well, what are you watching? I'm like, well, I love The Vampire Diaries. You know what I mean? So epic romance, like I'm such a romantic. So that's something I definitely want to do.
You know, it took me about a year of auditioning to realize that the dream part was not going to exist for me unless I wrote it. So I'm working on that.
And I told you I was going to bother you about this. Tell us a little bit more. We know you're working on something. Give us a little, I want a little hint. Like, what world of things are you thinking about?
You know, there's a story in there. It's my story, but it's the story of my friends. It's the story of my mother. It's the story of my ex-boyfriends. I'm really sorry. you know, it's I'm working on a script. I don't know what form it's going to take, where it's going to go. I have friends who are supporting me in it, and I think more than anything, it's just been really sweet and nourishing to have this little baby that I get to come home to. You know, I audition for this, I audition for this, I don't get this, oh, I'm not working, what am I doing? It's like, through all of that, if you come back to like this thing that you have that belongs to you, I think that's really nourishing for an actor, because you're always putting yourself at the mercy of other people to cast you. Make your own work, even if you never do anything with it. Just like type it out or something. Yeah.
It's good. I've seen a bit of it.
Oh, you have?
Kelvin read it.
It's really good.
Why don't you ask him? Maybe he'll say it.
Yeah. He transcribed it for me. No, how about you? What are your ambitions?
My ambitions in
this sense, yeah.
To be happy. Huh? That's a Beyonce reference. Pretty, yeah.
In terms of maybe perhaps like going after your own kind of work or developing the kind of things you want to do. Obviously, you're getting cast in everything right now, so you're not a shortage of work.
I'm always just looking for things that educate me and help me grow as a person. So if it means a book I read, or if it means a story that I heard about, then I'm gonna look into it and research it and figure out if there's a way to make it happen. So yeah.
And Rachelle, does this, I mean, you weren't looking for a part when you were on that, no, on the G train. Does this change?
Yeah, I mean, like, I don't know. Sometimes me and Nia joke, like, we just met this person on the train. Like, what are we doing? But no, I mean, I think, like, this role was really close to my own character, so it's almost like me. And it would be fun to try to play characters that are not like me at all, you know, like, different, don't skateboard, like non-skateboarding roles or things like that. But I feel like, you know, yeah, I mean, it's kind of like my safety blanket, that's why it's here right now. But I'll try to put it away for another role or something. But I mean, a cool movie, if this movie were ever to be made, I would want to be in it. The Alchemist. I would want to be a part of that. Like maybe like a stranger that the boy like runs into or something. Love that book. Great. If you haven't read it, read it. It's lit.
We'll do another question. Right there. Hold on, we'll get you a mic. Thank
you. This is in reference to the film Monster. I guess, how do you plan to use your voice as an actor and certainly a fresh face to give a voice to those who don't have one, as misrepresented black people, especially on trial?
That's a great question. I think what the movie does is it automatically creates a platform. In the website, we have a lot of programs and all the research materials that kind of enlighten you about, you know, the percentages and everything that's going on with incarceration. And I think that's a big step into it. But for me personally, being an activist, I think the best way I can participate is just by continuing to do films that create a conversation. That's what Monsters and Men is, that's what Monster is, you know, and that's how I plan to just keep doing stuff like these panels, and hopefully you go see the movie and support it, and then go to the website and do your own research and then figure out, you know, how do you want to participate. Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. Next question over here. We'll get you a microphone. Good, stand up. It's easier for them to find you with a microphone. Thank you.
So, in reference to Assassination Nation, which is in Midnight, I think, and it comes at night, movies like that are genre, horror or thriller or fantasy, things that don't exist in reality necessarily. As especially young actors who are lending your incredible talents to those films that are very hard to get made, does the process change for you when engaging with something that doesn't really exist, or do you approach it the same way?
Assassination Nation, it isn't unicorns, it isn't aliens, it isn't dragons, it isn't White Walkers. It's people. It's a big what if, but it's a possible what if. There's no magic. There's no... what's unrealistic is the scale of the violence and the persecution and the bigotry. But we've all seen that scale be exceeded in our times for what we thought was possible, the country we thought we're living in. So when you're acting it, you're imagining yourself in that situation. And honestly, when you're shooting a scene with an angry lynch mob of men banging on stuff with guns, there's a bunch of guys in front of you yelling and screaming, banging on their trucks with guns. So it's for Assassination Nation, I invested in the reality of it. There's not one part of me that treated it as a fantasy, because I don't think it is.
Next question.
There's a guy. He's like,
wait. Oh, sorry, I didn't see you back there. All right, we got you now.
This is kind of a hybrid of all of them, but we're looking at a juxtaposition of film right now where you're looking at these big studio movies that are retelling old stories. I mean, I think we're all in our third Spider-Man reboot, nothing against it, but as people that are constantly reading scripts and seeing stories, do you think that we're moving in a direction in which the independent storytelling format is able to more tell more accessible stories, and do you think that we're moving in that direction, or do you think that we're going to be stuck in the studio system forever?
Okay, I got it. Well, I feel like we're all moving in the new direction of indie films and the stories that haven't necessarily been told often. I think we're fed up in so many ways in this country, with politics, with the Me Too movement and everything, that I feel like as a whole, we're all ready for something new. And I think if we keep creating content and making sure that we're heard and seen, I don't think we could be turned away. I think the studios are gonna adapt to us if we make it a movement, if we say these voices need to be heard and these women directors and writers and creators have something to talk about.
You like, how are you like, you were really agreeing with that one.
Well,
you want to add to that?
I mean, all I was going to say was the studio system wouldn't be a bad place to be. Not that it's a bad place to be, but the nuance of the storytelling and the diversity
you know, we could have that if that was what the studios were putting on instead of, you know, the reboots and the franchises. Not that those are bad things, but, you know, there's only so much money going around in Hollywood. I'm not an expert on this. I just got here. But, but it seems pretty simple to me. If you have resources, put the resources behind something that's going to challenge and enrich audience members and not just something guaranteed to make coin. So, yeah.
I also think that if we change our perspective about it, who says these films can't make money? You know, I think we put in our mind that this is just not a money-making film. But if we give audiences and people the opportunity to support it, maybe we'll be pleasantly surprised.
Yeah. Another question? Right here. We'll get you a microphone.
So this is going off something Kelvin mentioned earlier. You said going into Monster, you had a lot of uncertainty and a lot of questions about the role. So I wanted to ask everyone, not just as actors, but as creators and artists, if you had a moment, whether it was on set or something, where you actually felt that everything started to come together, when you felt, you know, like a take was finished and you looked around and you said, yeah, we're going somewhere now, and what that moment was and how it kind of made you all feel.
I had that feeling when we filmed the last shot of the movie. And I guess it did all come together, that last shot, right? But I mean, in that one shot, I was with all my friends, all the cast was, you know, everything just felt right, and we were just skating and doing exactly what led us to this, you know, position in the first place. It's always just been about like skating and doing like what we love. And it kind of just hit me then in that moment, and all of us, we were all like pretty emotional, and like it was great. But yeah,
I think for me, one of the hardest moments, so like I said, we had rehearsals in Jordan's house, and one day I was running late, so I just put my hair up in a little pineapple thing, and I was like, whatever, I don't care. And I like ran, I got there, and Jordan was like, oh my God, that's beautiful. And I was like, what? She was like, your hair like that. And I was like, no, I didn't do it. I didn't brush it, I didn't do anything. She was like, no, I really think this is a character. And I was like, no, this is not the character. You did not have this in your mind before I came into it like this. So I was like, no, you know, and it for a lot of black women, natural hair is something that, you know, nobody could tell us. It could be the person you love the most in the world, and it could say you look so beautiful, but if you don't believe it and you don't feel it, then, you know, you don't want to listen to what anybody else has to say. And so that was a big challenge. And then we did a beach scene where, as you see my little sister in the film, she has her hair natural, and Angel has it natural too, but she has it there, and she has it like more of an afro type of thing. So there's a beach scene where like we get in the water, and I take the thing out, and then my afro is like free and shit, and it's like, I don't know if I can curse, sorry. But
go for it.
but so that was the moment to me where I realized that that is really beautiful, and it, and that was pretty much my nudity, being that I've never been on film like that. So for me, but I always said if I have something that a character needs and I don't do it because of how I feel or how I felt look, then I'm not doing my job. So I'm thankful to Jordana for pushing for that look, because I really do believe that it's Angel, and I do think it helps tell a story.
For me, it was you know, a lot of Monster takes place in a prison. And it was the first day we shot at the prison. It was the first time I'd ever been in. And I was just in the cell pretty much all day. And Anthony, the director, wanted to just capture that rawness of it all. But it was the first time everything clicked. I was like, okay, I don't really know this kid. Okay, I'm trying to figure out, he's from Harlem, all right, he's cool, all right, he's an artist, all right. All this stuff's going, all right, cool. And then you sit in there and you go, what is this about? And I look into this mirror and I'm in this jumpsuit, and the door closes and vanity is completely removed. And I'm like stripped down, and I finally get to see, who am I? You're forced to kind of go, who am I, and why are people doing this to me? And then I was like, okay, that's what the movie is about. It's this, these perceptions and all these ideas, and everyone telling you who you're supposed to be as a black man, and these boxes everyone wants to put you in. And you're kind of like, wow, why? Why? You know, why? Why? Why am I these things? And anyway, it forced me to kind of dig deep into the who am I, and yeah.
Gun practice. We had to train to do all of these stunts, and there was a lot of work with guns, and I was watching Big Little Lies at the time. I was kind of feeling it. And I don't know, I was in that practice gun range in New Orleans, Louisiana. I took a shotgun, there was like a little clown target, and I shot that clown's nose right off. From a long way, and I was just like, okay, I'm ready, let's do this.
Next up, who's got a question? I'll take this one. I feel like when you're breaking through, when you're coming up, everybody's got advice. It's not always good. like producers, directors, colleagues, I feel like people can't help but say, here's what you should do, or here's what I wish I'd known. Do you have any examples of good advice or terrible advice you've gotten in the last few months, the last year or two?
Yeah, Crystal, the director, always like emphasized the idea of what we call it, the flow, and it's just like kind of trying to just like not take control over the like the way things are going, and you know, to you know, be too like trying to manage everything, just kind of like flow within, whatever happens will happen, and to let loose, and like if it's supposed to happen, then it'll just work out. And I feel like for her to say that, it really was a, you know, I really needed to hear it, because I think being human, you just kind of want everything to be perfect, you know, we strive for control over everything, and if you just let loose and just do what you love, and like things will just come your way in the flow. So yeah.
This wasn't from producers or actors even. It was like, it's kind of family members. So obviously being Darlene in the Deuce is a big deal. So I wrote an open letter to my family and friends, because a lot of people would, you know, see me at family reunions or whatever, and they'll be like, oh, I can't wait to see your show. And I'm like, well, this is about this, and you'll be prepared for that. And then and they're like, well, you don't have to do that. And I don't like that comment at all, because I know I don't have to do something. You know, they say, oh, you don't have to be topless to be an actress. I said, I know I don't have to. You know what I mean? But if I'm taking a role, it's because I believe in it. So I think a lot of times, I mean, they mean well, but sometimes they don't really understand. They think that somebody's putting something on you, and not having the faith to know that you can say no if something is not what you want to do. I know that I don't have to do something, but if I choose to do it, it's because I believe in it. And I think that was something I had to like let them know. Please don't tell me, oh, you don't do this or don't do that, or you don't have to do this to be an actor. Like, that's one of my pet peeves. Yeah.
Advice good, bad?
The best advice I've gotten was just watching someone like Jennifer Ely, who was in that clip. She's a phenomenal actress, so incredibly talented, and she's the nicest woman I've ever met. Like, that taught me so much about, she comes to set early, she gets dressed immediately, she goes straight to hair and makeup, she knows everyone's name, she learned every extra in the stand or in the courtroom's name, and she would greet them every morning. It's like, that's the kind of energy you need to bring to like work every day. That's what makes people excited to come to work, and that's what makes people want to work with you again. And I was like, I might be not good all the time, but if I'm nice, you might give me a chance. Go the long way.
How about you? Advice good or terrible?
I've always found it interesting when people are giving you pointers about, like, you know, how to get calm when you're nervous, you know, a thing you can think about, or like a pill you can take or whatever. I feel like nerves are a gift, and it's just energy waiting to, you know, be funneled through your magical snowflake crystal and be broadcast to the world. Those are nerves to me. So I've been trying to use my nerves and not like calm down, because then you're just calm.
Right. Do another question. Your turn. Come on, y'all. Right here. We'll get you a microphone though first.
So how do you, as young artists, sort of, I always am wondering,
because I feel like there's so many people who are saying, these are the ways that you have to do these things, and these are, because you talk a lot about boxes, and these are the boxes you have to live in, and this is the way you have to get things done, and you know, you can create your own work, but that's gonna be so hard, and you're not gonna make it that way, and everybody creates their own work. How do you combat that sort of, I guess, negativity and preventing you from even trying before you get a chance to start?
I think maybe I combat that by talking about my faith. That's how I combat it. You know, I say, well, if this has been a trajectory of my career right now, then I shouldn't put anybody else's perceptions or experiences or fears on myself, because that's not my testimony and that's not my reality. So I think that's how I combat it. I combat it by constantly creating work. I combat it by manifestation. I do vision boards and all that. You know, I really believe in that. And a lot of my dreams have come to fruition. So I kind of, like, you know, the proof is in the pudding. So I just kind of show them that. You know, I'm like I said from before, I'm from East New York. And I'm from, that's considered the hood or the ghetto. And a lot of people don't have faith in the youth and the community over there. So I think I show them that it is possible.
I mean, how about the rest of you? I do feel like this is a really interesting moment in the industry where it's never felt kind of so awful on one side as all this stuff is being exposed, but also really hopeful because there's a lot of interesting work happening right now and a lot of boundaries being broken at this moment.
Well, I think these types of films, like the independent films and all that, people are seeing like the inside scoop of like what might be seen as like what people might stereotype others as. Like, they're, for example, for like the skate girl skaters, I mean, like, they're really getting into the character's reality and like seeing their perspective, and this kind of will create that, allow them to have their own like experience with it by just watching it. Like, they're transported into it, into their shoes. And I feel like that's just gonna normalize a lot of things that we may be kind of like questioning all the time. And normalizing things is, you know, good. Like, just, it's all real. So it's like, I feel like it's cool.
And I try to remind myself that life isn't short, life is long. And I feel like the people who are saying those things are the same people who are like, you know, rushing you to the finish line. You need to do this and this and this by the time you're this, and we want to do this many things this year, and you need to make this much money. It's like, we all have to do what we all have to do to survive, but I feel like slow burning it and moving at a pace that is just livable for you, that allows you to, like, you know, get your sleep and eat your food and see your family and walk your dog, like, you know, I try to slow, because my impulse is to go, go, go. So I consciously, and that's a lot of millennials too. That's our generation, because it all seems so accessible to us. Mm-hmm. But I think just doing a slow thing, and like, if it takes me 5 years to like write this thing or whatever, okay, because you'll get it done. I don't know.
I agree.
Mm-hmm. Another question here on the aisle. We'll get you a microphone. Thank you.
So who are some other fresh faces that you're excited about? Actors, directors, musicians, or models? And, you know, what of their work that you're, like, excited about and why?
Great question. I can't wait to hear this.
You guys like Khalid, singer? Young, Dumb, and Broke?
Yeah.
It's a good song. Yeah. Abra, she's here actually, Abra, which is amazing.
Yeah, Abra's one of my co-stars in Assassination Nation. She's a kick-ass musician, and she kills it in this film.
She's so good.
She's amazing. I just want to shout out my co-stars in Assassination Nation, Sookie Waterhouse, Odessa, Abra as well. I mean, you know, these are the girls, and they rock, and you're going to be seeing more of them. And Kelvin. Calvin's one of the girls.
Yes.
Yeah.
Anyone you two are excited about?
There's a director that I just met. His name is Nabil Elderkin. He's so cool. And he's just like so talented.
Say the name again, I'm
Nabil
sorry.
Elderkin. Uh-huh. He's a music video director. He's done like stuff for Travis Scott, John, like the list is ridiculous. But he's so passionate and he has like, I don't know, he's an infectious energy. And I went to his house and he was just talking about some stuff and I was just like, this guy. I can't wait till he makes a movie.
Yeah. Going off for the same thing, I recently got the honor to play Jay-Z's mother in his music video for Smile. And that was directed by Miles J, and he's a new director, but he's phenomenal. I feel like the whole world needs to know who he is, and they will. And I just remember he's 28 years old, and he got this opportunity to do a Jay-Z video, and I remember they came to him with another idea, and he was brave enough to say, like, make a treatment for Smile, even though they didn't have plans on doing a video for that. And I think a lot of people would have been like, oh, just take whatever Jay-Z's gonna give you, but he was brave enough to say, well, in my art, this one speaks to me, and, you know, maybe I could change their mind with this story that I'm gonna create. And so he created the story and they liked it and yeah, just Miles J is his name and he's incredible.
Terrific. We'll do one last question. Okay, over here. Bring it on home.
Hi, let's go, I guess after all those pretty complex and thought-provoking questions, let's go to something a little more simple. In your future, whether it could be whoever actor or director, who would you want to work with in your acting career the most?
That list is too. I feel like the list is so long. I can't just say one, and then I'm gonna be like, and then this person. But I have extreme admiration for Meryl Streep. I'm sure everybody does. But I remember being in school and a lot of my friends trying to get agents and stuff like that. And I said, well, Dom, like you said about taking it slow. My grandmother, she passed away, but she never talked to me ever about anything acting. The one thing she ever told me was, take it nice and slow, Dommy, take it nice and slow. And so I always held fast to that piece of advice because she didn't talk about these type of things. And so when everybody was trying to get an agent, I said, well, what I could do is like make sure that when I do get an agent and I get in the room that I'm able to deliver. So the craft is more important. That's the most important thing. And I just remember always thinking in school, being like, well, you know, if somebody doesn't like Meryl Streep, they can never say she can't act. And that's what I want to be. If they're not gonna love me or like me, I hope to God I'll be able to make them say that, you know, at least that girl can act, you know?
David Lynch, if you're watching this right now. Hello.
We'll send him the link afterwards.
Yeah.
Great. I'm obsessed with Tilda Swinton and Lynn Ramsey. I think they are just, first of all, Tilda just disappears in everything she does. And I would love to work with her on anything. She can play my mom, my girlfriend, I don't know what.
Last up.
Well, I can't really think of one right now, but I would want to work with you guys.
Oh. What?
Ditto.
That's perfect.
We did
Smile as well. She was in Smile.
Yeah, low key, we did work together.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
Like in Smile, I was one of the girls.
But it's great interviewing you all for the first time. I can't wait to be talking to you on these long careers you're going to have. Thank you all for coming. We really appreciate it.